We know in sports science, it is critically important to both analyze and visualize your data in a clear and meaningful way, not just for yourself, but also for staff, for the coaches, and of course, for the athletes themselves. Now, I've previously talked about Z scores and gone through how you calculate them, how you can use them. If you're not familiar with them or you haven't already watched that video, I'll pop a link below. Today, we're going to look at the next step. That is taking your Z score and converting it into either a STEN score or a T score. And these can be even more useful for feeding back your information in a really clear manner. My name's Jo Clubb and I am a sports science consultant, and I try to help make sports science digestible for teams, practitioners and athletes all around the world. And today we're going to be talking all about T-scores and STEN scores. Now, a really quick recap then on the Z-score. We take today's score, or the score that we're interested in comparing, and we subtract the group average, whether that's for an individual over time or them compared to their peers, the reference group average, and we then divide that by the reference group standard deviation. Again, if you're not familiar with a Z-score, please have a quick look at that other video first. That then gives us the number of standard deviations that that score is away from the mean in reference to this comparison data set. But people sometimes struggle to understand what standard deviations represent. What does a Z score of 1.5 or minus 0.7 actually represent? And this is where both the STEN score or the T score can come in. So first of all, we're going to take a look at STEN score. So the STEN score is standard 10 score. It converts the Z score to between 1 and 10, with 0, the average, corresponding to a STEN score of 5.5. So we calculate the STEN by taking the Z score, timesing it by 2, and then adding on 5.5. Here we have a few examples of Z scores and their corresponding STEN scores. And you can immediately see how the Z scores are transformed into figures that are much more natural to us in this range between 1 and 10. So minus 1.5 becomes 2.5. A 0.3 Z score is 6.1. Remember, the average on this scale is 5.5. Whereas a high Z score of 2.1 becomes 9.7. Clearly on the higher end towards that top number of 10. So here we have an example from Heidi Thornton, now Heidi Compton, from this paper entitled Developing Athlete Monitoring Systems in Team Sports, Data Analysis and Visualization. And I highly recommend taking a look at this paper. I'll link to this paper below because it has some really interesting and very practical recommendations for your visualization and your feedback. And in this example here, it's in black and white. In reality, there's a traffic light system of colors going on here, but we have total distance for player over time with the corresponding STEN score for that total distance calculated and then overlaid onto this traffic light coloring system. So a similar but slightly different alternative then is to calculate a T score. Now the T score gives you a number between, it's between 0 and 100, but in reality, it's most frequently between 20 and 80 with a Z score of 0. So an average score corresponding to the number 50 for a T score. We calculate this by taking a Z score, multiplying it by 10, and then adding on 50. So let's look at some examples, and we use the same Z scores that we used in our STEN example as well. So remember, most of your Z scores are going to fall within this 20 to 80 range for the T score, and we see that here. So minus 1.5 Z score becomes 35 on the T score scale, whereas 0.3, clearly around average for a Z score, becomes 53, because on this scale, 50 is the middle point. And our high Z score of 2.1 corresponds to a T score of 71.
So then let's look at another publication demonstrating the use of this statistic. And again, highly recommend this paper. This is by John McMahon, known as the Force Plate Coach. And the paper is entitled Force Plate Derived Countermovement Jump Normative Data and Benchmarks for Professional Rugby League Players. Again, this paper is a fantastic blend with providing practical applications to the reader. And we can see here how John and the fellow authors have presented the Z-score overlaid with the T-score and the corresponding figures, but then also applied this traffic light system to the numbers. We can see this range between 20 and 80 from extremely poor to excellent, but breaking down within the different thresholds as well. And this paper gives us a couple of different visualization options. I really like this one that they've proposed, where you could plot a team across this color-coded system. You could even line it up again, not with the T-score, but actually with what the number is in reality. So in this case, jump height. The real numbers of jump height, in this case for two position groups, are overlaid with the corresponding bands and threshold for the T-score color coding. And we can see the whole team there plotted against each other. You could probably do this as well for one player over time, depending on how many data points you had, if you wanted to see different data points and potentially label them with the date, and we could see perhaps how that was trending. We could also take that and turn that into a bar chart with these layers of colors in the background to show the change over time. Now, another thing you might need to do is reverse engineer the T-scores to calculate what the corresponding number for a metric is for each boundary, so that we can set that up with our data visualization. Here we have 11 different athletes with their jump height shown. And for this group, we have our average and our standard deviation calculated. And so we have our Z score for each athlete, as well as our T score. Now, if you don't know this trick here with the dollar sign, I'm not going to go into that today, but that is discussed in the Z score video. And so what we might want to know is, for the boundaries, for the thresholds and the descriptors that are given in John McMahon's paper, what for jump height in this group corresponds to that T-score. So again, using the chart shown in John McMahon's paper, we've got the Z-scores corresponding to our boundaries. And how we calculate the T-score is basically a reverse engineering of the Z-score. The Z-score for that boundary multiplied by the standard deviation, and then add on the average for the group. So I can copy this down now, and we can see that in this athlete group, for this metric of jump height, we now have our thresholds for the different descriptors as given in the McMahon paper.
So there you have a couple of really simple but useful statistics for transforming your data into a meaningful scale and giving you options for data visualization as well. If you enjoyed this video, please hit subscribe so you don't miss out on another sports science insights video coming very soon.